be more than human.
Hello and welcome back to the channel. My name is Joseph Carroll. I write under the pen name J.R. Carroll. And today, guys, we are finally on
Peace Talks.
And this is a kind of a exciting read for me. I love Dresden, as you all know, and I believe I've read through the beginning to Skin Game 5 times, but this was my first reread of Peace Talks. If I sound a little weird, gonna have to bear with me, guys. I'm a little under the weather. I know some people will be like, Joe, I wouldn't make the video if I was you. But if you were me, then I'd be you and then use your body to make the video. You can't stop me no matter who you are. Let's go. So, Peace Talks, we had a 5-year gap in between Skin Game and Peace Talks. Now, we all knew, if you came in as it dropped, that Peace Talks was in conjunction with Battlegrounds. I think there was like a 2 or 3 month time in between the release. So, no books for 5 years, 2 in 1 year. I think, you know, he's kind of splitting the difference. He's like, you know, one of the first things as we got into this book, you know, we kind of pick up right where we left off. Murphy is kind of battered and beaten, and her and Dresden are now a thing. You know, they're an item. They're, you know, it's finally happened, right? But Dresden is in this, you know, weird way of, okay, I want to be with Murphy. I want to be with Murphy, but she's hurt. I don't want to hurt her. My instincts as the Winter Knight are to just, you know, take, right? That's what the Winter Mantle does, is take. But so he's fighting that off. And then we also find out that Dresden is sometimes or mostly living at Molly's apartment or house, however you want to go about it, at Svartalfheim, at their little apartment complex. And Maggie is there with him. And their dynamic is, it's awesome. It's finally great to see, you know, Harry, you know, becoming a dad. And it's great to see Mouse is there and the interactions with all of the Svartalfheim, if I can even talk today. You know, how Maggie, you know, he's kind of showing off Maggie's, you know, personality and everything. And then, you know, Thomas shows up and they're just, you know, talking and, you know, and then we hear about the peace talks that are going to happen between the, you know, the leaders of the Fomor and all the Accord nations. So that is the looming thing in the background, is okay, the peace talks are coming together. And we know, you know, if you know Dresden, you know that's going to be, you know, that's going to be the craziness, right? That's going to happen. But also, as I always say in these Dresden things, there's never just one thing. You know, very rarely in any book is there just one story going on. There's always at least two, and Dresden has to kind of work his way through, you know, all of that. And we find out that Dresden has to, you know, he gets in his little monster mobile, and in the back, who's in the back of the car? But Mab and Laura Wraith. And Laura must have done something. I forget exactly what they said she did. They weren't super specific, but she helped Mab, so now Mab's giving her 3 things to ask of Harry. So, you know, Harry's kind of indebted to her through this book, which becomes, you know, a big thing later on. But also something really heavy in this book is Ebenezer finally butting heads with Thomas. You know, they kind of had words at the beginning of the book, and then throughout the entire book, you know, Ebenezer's really pushing Harry on, why are you always around this vampire? Why are you always around this vampire? I hate vampires. And they even have a conversation of where Harry is talking to Ebenezer, and Ebenezer's like, yeah, the way you hate ghouls, why do you hate ghouls? And as we know, you know, those ghouls out in the desert killed those kids, and now Harry's like, has, like, just wants to kill every ghoul he ever sees. Well, that's the way Ebenezer feels about the White Court vampires, or vampires in general. So that is just, they're butting heads the entire time, and you knew that this was going to happen. And I don't know if this was Jim's plan from the beginning, but it seems like, you know, 5 years off, it seems like he really wanted to give us a lot of things that we were wanting, you know, or a lot of things that maybe we were expecting. He's like, well, I'm putting out two books, you know, putting out two books this year, so I'm just going to start putting a lot of stuff. And some people did feel like or at least Peace Talks was kind of crammed with, you know, just things in general. But I really, really loved it. And I actually like when an author kind of, like, listens to his fans. And he's like, okay, you guys want something? Well, I'll give you something. And so, Thomas, you know, the secondary thing in this book ends up being that Svartalfheim, or, you know, Harry's apartment complex, catches on fire. Of course it does. Of course Harry's place that he lives catches on fire. And when he runs in to kind of make sure Maggie's okay and everything, you know, one really fun thing we found out was, you know, the Svart Elves can kind of, they're really great with earth magic, and they can go through floors and walls and the ground. But as Harry goes into the apartment, like, they couldn't get in the apartment because he put his own wards on the apartment, and Mouse is in there, and every time one of the Svart Elves tries to come up through the floor, Mouse, you know, comes down and uses his magic or whatever, the blue aura, and he's bam, tries to slam on him, and they're like, we're not going to be able to get through past that demon or whatever they call him, the protector spirit. But you know, once, you know, Harry kind of gets them out or whatever, the Svart Elves take him to you know, their, like, headquarters in the building. And he figures out that they were under attack, and one of their leaders was an assassination attempt was attempted, and actually one of their guards got killed by Thomas. And I'm sitting here like, what? You know, Thomas is trying to attack, and he is so severely beaten that he can't really talk. The only thing he can say is Justine, and you're sitting there thinking, Okay, yeah, he wants to make sure Harry has to take care of Justine. That's what we're, thinking here. But also, definitely something is not right. You know, Thomas is not just going to randomly run in there and just kill a dude for no reason. I'm thinking he's getting blackmailed. Something like that. We actually learned that the reason he was able to get in there is because he goes in there and hooks up with a bunch of the women, Svart Elf woman, which is just such a Thomas thing to do. So now Harry is like, how am I going to get him out of here? This is one of the most fortified places. I'd be basically declaring war on them. He talks with Molly. He actually summons Molly in a circle, and, you know, we kind of figure out that Molly is maybe not exactly Molly anymore, but she's still Molly in other ways. Harry's wrestling with, is he himself completely, and then is Molly her? But he decides she's still Molly and I'm still Harry, and we're just going to kind of, work our way through this. But it was funny, the scene where she is in the circle with Nutella and was it Dr. Pepper or something, and she's like, I haven't eaten in 3 days, and so that was pretty cute to see. But you know, he asks her for a favor, and the thing about it is, I mean, this was really cool and weird at the same time. But he asked her for a favor, and of course, she's, you know, a fairy now, so she had to seal it with a kiss, and now he owes her a favor that he has to repay at some point, and it has to be equal to what she did. But now Harry has to figure out how can he save his brother, right? How can he save Thomas? And now he's got to go to the peace talks. And, you know, Murphy knows that shit's about to hit the fan, so she's got, all these casts and stuff, and she starts cutting the casts off with power tools and shit, and you're just like, that's such a Murphy thing to do. And then when we get to the peace talks, it's almost like an upped version of Grave Peril's party scene. And it's so cool. Like, it's like he gives you the greatest hits. Like, all the people that you know, Faravax. We finally see Faravax again. And him and Vadron, Odin, are kind of eyeballing each other or having a staring competition from across the room. You got the leaders of, like, a big ghoul noble, like the king of Louisiana ghouls. Who else do we see? I mean, we just see... The best reveal ever is, you know, Harry sitting there and he feels a big, you know, giant hand on his shoulder and he's about to attack it, and it's River Shoulders. Now, if you have only read the novels themselves, then you will not have met River Shoulders, but you would have heard his name spoken in Skin Game, and you should definitely... read or listen to all the side stories that he's put together, all the short stories, and working the collection of three stories working for Bigfoot might be my favorite of all of them. And River Shoulders is just awesome. He's just awesome, and you know what he's capable of if you've read or listened to those stories. So I loved his banter back and forth with Harry about, you know, well, I've kept secret, my people have kept secret all these years, but now you have kind of, showed me that we probably should be more, forefront of at least the magical community. And you basically have a Bigfoot there that's all like hair slicked back. He's got glasses and he's wearing a suit and stuff, so it would just I'm just seeing that in my head and thinking, how ridiculously awesome is this? And it's so Dresden. But so they have their little first day. And of course the summer court and the winter court are there, and Laura's there. So that's like the little first day pre-party that they go to. And then so when they leave, you know, him and Laura and Murphy are trying to figure out a way that they can get Thomas back. And so the White Council was there as well, and Laura has Harry as one of her favors, has Harry introduce her to Kristoff, I want to say his name is, one of the head wizards that definitely is, or at least we think, is probably a part of the Black Council, and or he's just naive, but he thinks he's Mr. Communicate to Anybody. So those two are talking with the leader of the Svartalfheim, and so he gets them to transfer. And the peace talks are all taking place at Marcone's castle on Harry's old boarding house property. So Thomas gets transferred there, and of course now it's all now we're about heisting Thomas out of there. And so, you know, it's, you know, kind of Skin Game-esque. You know, everybody has their skill and how they're going to get through. And it's a pretty, you know, it's a pretty cool thing, you know. And there's another Valkyrie that we meet. And she works for Laura. And her name is Freitas. And she is kind of like Harry back in the original books. Like, just very sexually frustrated. And she's like, oh, she dances with Harry. And it's like, hey, you know, I like, you know, basically like, oh, I like tough, tall guys or whatever. And then he's like, oh, I'm with Murphy. She's like, oh, you know, I think Murphy's hot too because she put a gun in my face or something. It is just, Freitas is just a riot. So we're sitting here with, you know, Thomas being moved to, you know, over to the castle. And actually, when they, you know, start the heist or whatever to get him back, he's in Harry's sub-basement is where it's being held, and he's all busted up. So they're actually, you know, through a bunch of magic, you know, a lot of, like, Laura has to use her kind of sexual vampire magic on one of the undead Vikings. And they get him out, but as they're coming out under a veil, they see that King Korb, all right, the Fomor here, they pull up in a limousine type vehicle, and as soon as they get out, he has his men just kill people who are in the, you know, guarding the front door or whatever. And you're like, what the hell? And then this giant woman kind of, gets out, or person gets out, and you're like, what the heck is going on here? And then he hands them, he has a chain attached to his neck and hands it to them, and you're like, oh, freaking K. So what is above the King of the Fulmore, right? So, you know, what's going on? And Harry's like, I gotta see what's going on here. You guys go ahead. And he's trying to send them out to the island. Get to the water beetle and get out to the island with Thomas. And so Harry follows him back inside. And it turns out that the giant is Ethnew. Basically, you know, she's called the Last Titan. She's like a proto-god of Celtic origin. And she just walks in, and she basically starts shitting on everyone. She's like, you don't matter, you don't matter, you know, why are you looking at me? She actually has Pharaoh Vax, you know, kind of forces him, you know, like, kind of like stares at him, putting her will on him to make him introduce who she is. And then she looks over at Odin, and she calls him One Eye, and she's like, you know, basically, like, you used to be something, you know, you used to be respectable, powerful, like, and now you're allowing them to have any say. So we feel like, you know, at least Odin is on her level, maybe, you know, is what we're thinking here. And, you know, and then also, like, even though she did that to Fairvax, it feels like, you know, Fairvax might also kind of be on her level. But then she basically tells Mab, she's like, you're nothing. And then we get a reveal about, you know, basically Mab used to date or was in a relationship with Merlin when she was immortal, apparently. And you know, and I guess he either broke up with her or kicked her to the side or whatever. And apparently he, Ethnew, called him the Destroyer, or the Conqueror, something like that. I think it was the Destroyer. So apparently Merlin was really that much of a badass that even, you know, Titans respected him. But she just walks straight up to Mab and kicks Mab in the fucking chest like a Spartan, puts her through the wall, and then reveals, pulls her, cloak all the way back. And of course she's beautiful. She's covered in bronze from her top of her neck down, I think. And she has this eye that's bigger than the rest, and apparently that's her father's eye, the Eye of Balor. And we figure out that it's a freaking super weapon because she looks up and uses it to, like, it pulses and then blows like a laser, almost like a laser beam or something, through the top of this fortress, which in early, when Dresden first saw it, he was talking it up about how much spells it's got casted on it and it's so strong, and she just blows through the top of it and then they disappear, and like now everybody's scrambling like, well, and you got the ghouls like, I'm getting the hell out of here. And but Marcone actually stood up to Esnew before she disappeared and was like, hey, why are you breaking the rules, and like, we can work this out, what can we do? But he's also the one that stands up and says, hey, everyone, we signed on to the accords, this is our city. And she basically told him before she left that she's gonna just come in and just kill all the mortals. She doesn't give a shit. Like, she's like, I'm going old school on these people. And so it's like, okay, like, what are we gonna do? And everyone's like, some people are like, well, look what happened to Mab, and if we're, the only reason we're on the accords is because we're afraid of Mab. And eventually Mab does walk back through after Molly goes in and gets her, and she's all mangled and stuff, and you can, and she starts popping all her bones back into place. And and so Harry's like, all right, well, these people are trying to figure this out. I'm getting the hell out of here. He gets on, and gets back to the water beetle, and Ebenezer shows up. And he's like, you're going to start a war over this vampire that you've stolen from them. And Harry's like, yeah. And then him and Ebenezer end up throwing down. And it's an amazing fight. I mean, the way Jim Butcher's is probably the best battle writer ever. They're battling back and forth, and the boat's getting further away, and Harry's basically trying to keep him from destroying the boat so it can get out there. And in this battle, they as they do, they talk and banter back and forth, and then he finally, I personally, some people don't agree with me, but there's a point in this fight where I believe Harry says he could have brained Ebenezer if he wanted to. Like, he's like, oh, Ebenezer slipped and I could have brained him, which means, could have killed him. So that's a big thing to me. It's like, okay, Harry could have beaten the best battle wizard on Earth, but some people don't agree. And at the end of this, Ebenezer starts getting the upper hand, and Harry reveals that Thomas is his grandson as well. And Ebenezer just kind of loses his mind, and Harry's like, yeah. Harry kind of jumps up, and Ebenezer accidentally shoots off like this, like, comet-sized thing, shoots through Harry's lung and out his spine, he said. And he sits there, and he fucking dies. Not quite. Of course, that was a construct, and that was the favor that he asked of Molly earlier, was to help, I don't know if it's, I think it was a, it might have been a ring, but it, yeah, it was basically a really good construct, and, so he's actually on the boat, and they're disappearing, and he's basically like, yeah, see ya, Ebenezer, and they get out to the island, and his way of helping Thomas, because Thomas has been beaten so bad that the only thing that's left is the demon. The demon's eating his body. And he goes up by himself with Thomas and has Demon Reach entomb him in one of the crystals and puts him below. And Lara didn't understand what was going on. So she's like, I'm going to try to kill him. And then we get to see how powerful Harry has become on the island, where he just basically has the island suck her down and has, like, and battles Freydis with trees and everything. And you're just like, holy crap. I mean, he's got so much power. And he even, and then of course Harry talks with Demon Reach after they kind of cool, everyone cools down. And he's like, hey, how big of a thing can you contain? And he's like, physical size is not a problem. And he's like, are you speaking of the Titan? And he's like, yeah. He goes, if you can bind her, I can contain her. And so Harry goes, tells Demon Reach, he needs the spear of, basically the spear of destiny that he got from the underworld, and the sign, basically the one that I'm pretty sure it says, the one that says King of the Jews. And he's like, you need two of them? He goes, hey, go big or go home, basically. And that's kind of where we're going from here. It's like, all right, guys, we're getting ready for Battlegrounds, and this will be my first reread. And I remember I couldn't hardly breathe the first time I read Battlegrounds, because it's all gas, no brakes. So, you won't have to wait long. I'll probably have Battlegrounds review up here in the next week. Make sure you're subscribed. So many things Dresden. We do Dresden discussions here at least once a month. So remember, be more than human.